السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. All thanks and praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may His peace and blessings be upon His last and final messenger, His family, His companions, and those who follow them until the end of times. Welcome to lesson number 167 of Tafsir al-Jalalain. Alhamdulillah, yesterday we were able to complete verses 77 through 91 of Surah Al-Kahf. So inshallah today we'll pick up right where we left off with verse number 92. And just as a reminder, we are currently in the middle of the story of Dhul-Qarnayn. He has traveled to the west, he's traveled to the east, and now he's traveling towards the north. قال الإمام جلال الدين المحلي رحمه الله ثم اتبع سببا حتى إذا بلغ بين السدين بفتح السين وضمها هنا وبعد هما جبلان بمنقطع بلاد الترك سد الإسكندر ما بينهما كما سيأتي وجد من دونهما أي أمامهما قوما لا يكادون يفقهون قولا أي لا يفهمونه إلا بعد بطء وفي قراءة بضم الياء وكسر القاف قالوا يا ذي القرنين إن يأجوج ومأجوج بالهمز وتركه هما اسمان أعجميان لقبيلتين فلم ينصرفا مفسدون في الأرض بالنهب والبغي عند خروجهم إلينا فهل نجعل لك خرجا جعلا من المال وفي قراءة خراجا على أن تجعل بيننا وبينهم سدا حاجزا فلا يصلون إلينا. So here in verse number 92, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Dhul Qarnayn now continues on his journey. And after conquering and establishing justice for the people of the east, he decides to follow another path towards the north. ثُمَّ أَتْبَعَ سَبَبًا Then he traveled a course. He traveled on. حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ بَيْنَ السَّدَّيْنِ Until he reached a pass or a place between two mountains. وَجَدَ مِن دُونِهِمَا قَوْمًا لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ قَوْلًا He found in front of them a people who could hardly understand his language. He found besides these two mountains a people, a nation, a community who could barely understand him. So here Imam al-Mahalli says, ثُمَّ اتَّبَعَ سَبَبًا And as we discussed yesterday, Imam al-Mahalli, he's using a different qira'ah, where the verb is اتَّبَعَ from bab افتِعَال, verb from number 8. اتَّبَعَ يَتَّبِعُ Whereas the qira'ah that we are more familiar with uses verb for number 4. اتَّبَعَ يُتْبِعُ And the meaning essentially is the same, that then he traveled on. He traveled another course. حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ بَيْنَ السَّدَّيْنِ Until he reached between the two mountains. And he says the word سَدَّيْن بِفَتْحِ السِّينِ There's a fatha on the scene. The vowel on top of the scene is a fatha. وَضَمِّهَا But can also be recited with a ضَمَّ بَيْنَ السُّدَّيْنِ هُنَا وَبَعْدُ يعني here, in this verse, it's سَدَّيْنِ or سُدَّيْنِ And afterwards, same thing. There could be a fatha on the scene or a dhamma on the scene. هُمَا جَبَنَانِ And it's referring to two mountains. بِمُنْقَطَعِ بِلَادِ التُّرْكِ Right, at a distant place of the land of the Turks. Now that's according to one interpretation and one understanding. And this is actually a huge discussion amongst the mufassirun and the scholars that what is the exact location of these two mountains? What is the exact location of where Dhul Qarnayn built this huge barrier that is basically imprisoning Ya'juj and Ma'juj and is preventing them from wreaking havoc across the globe? Where exactly is this location? Allahu A'lam. Allah knows best. There are theories, you know, there are hypotheses, people guess, and you know, some scholars say it's where Imam al-Mahalli mentions, some say it's like in Central Asia, some say it's towards more Russia. Aqwal. There's all these different opinions, and at the end of the day, Allah knows best. Right, this is something that is in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Mahalli continues, سَدَّ الْإِسْكَنْدَرُ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا كَمَا سَيَأْتِي. That Iskandar, who he identified as Dhul Qarnayn, right, that's according to Imam al-Mahalli's conclusion, that this is al-Iskandar. And as we said, most modern researchers say it's Cyprus, right? Cyprus the Great. That he sadda ma baynahuma, right? He filled the space, the pass, the mountain pass between these two mountains, right? By creating this large wall, this large barrier. Kama sayati, as is going to come. وَجَدَ مِن دُونِهِمَا أَيْ أَمَامَهَا قَوْمًا. He found a nation, a people, in front of them. Right, meaning in front of these two mountains, their location, right, yani before the two mountains, in front of them, he found a nation, a community. لَا يَكَادُونَ, then Allah describes them. لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ قَوْلًا. Who could barely understand what he was saying. They could barely understand his language. A لَا يَفْهَمُونَهُ إِلَّا بَعْدَ بُطْءٍ. That they did not understand what Dhul Qarnayn was saying to them, except after a while, after a pause. It took them some time to understand him. And it is said because they spoke a foreign language and they had to use an interpreter, they had to use a translator, so there was a delay in communication. وَفِي قِرَاءَةٍ بِضَمِّ الْيَاءِ وَكَسْرِ الْقَافِ. In another qira'ah, instead of yafqahuna, it's yufqihuna. That they could barely make people understand their language because they spoke a different strange language, so people could not understand what they were saying. So one qira'ah has verb form number one, faqiha yafqahu, that they themselves couldn't understand. Or the other qira'ah is verb form number four, afqaha yufqihu, they couldn't make others understand. And both of the meanings are very similar. قالوا, they said, يَا ذَا الْقَرْنَيْنِ إِنَّ يَأْجُوجَ وَمَأْجُوجَ مُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَهَلْ نَجْعَلُ لَكَ خَرْجًا عَلَىٰ أَن تَجْعَلَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُمْ سَدًّا. They said, O ذُو الْقَرْنَيْنِ, surely يَأْجُوجَ and مَأْجُوجَ are spreading corruption throughout the land. Should we pay you a tribute? Should we give you some money so that you can build a wall between us and them? So you could build a barrier between us and them. So قالوا, they said, meaning this community of people, this nation said, أو ذو القرنين, surely يأجوج المأجوج. And he says بالهمزة, يعني يأجوج with a همزة, مأجوج with a همزة, وتركه ياجوج and ماجوج. Both ways of pronouncing it are correct. هما اسماني أعجمياني. These are two foreign names, لقبيلتين, for two tribes, فلم ينصرفا, and that's why they are غير منصرف. They are diptotes. In the Arabic language, there are words that are منصرف, and there are other words that are غير منصرف. غير منصرف means they do not receive, usually, they don't receive tanween or a kasra. So, إِنَّ يَأْجُوجَ وَمَأْجُوجَ, right, truly, these tribes of يَأْجُوج and مَأْجُوج, مُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ, are spreading corruption throughout the land. They are ruining this land. بِالنَّهْبِ وَالْبَغِي, by attacking and transgressing. They come down and they pillage and plunder and they destroy things and take everything and usurp things and steal everything and kill people. They are creating fasad, havoc, corruption in our land. عند خروجهم إلينا, particularly when they come down and out to us. فهل نجعل لك خرجا, so shall we pay you a tribute, جعلا, some sort of money, wages, من المال, should we give you some sort of payment. وفي قراءة خراجا, instead of خرجا, خراجا, same meaning, على أن تجعل بيننا وبينهم سدا, so that you can build a barrier between us and them. حاجزا, right, a barrier, a wall. فَلَا يَصِلُونَ إِلَيْنَا, so that they cannot reach us. This barrier will prevent them from coming and pillaging and plundering and, you know, creating this fasad. قَالَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, قَالَ مَا مَكَّنِّي وَفِي قِرَاءَةٍ بِنُونَيْنِ مِنْ غَيْرِ إِدْغَامٍ فِيهِ رَبِّي مِنَ الْمَالِ وَغَيْرِهِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ خَرْجِكُمْ أَلَّذِي تَجْعَلُونَهُ لِي. فلا حاجة بي إلي وأجعل لكم السد تبرعا فأعينوني بقوة لما أطلبه منكم أجعل بينكم وبينهم ردما حاجزا حصينا آتوني زبر الحديد قطعه على قدر الحجارة التي يبنى بها فبنى بها وجعل بينها الحطب والفحم حتى إذا ساوى بين الصدفين بضم الحرفين وفتحهما وضم الأول وسكون الثاني أي جانبي الجبلين بالبناء ووضع المنافخ والنار حول ذلك قال انفخوا فنفخوا حتى إذا جعله أي الحديد نارا أي كالنار قال آتوني أفرغ عليه قطرا هو النحاس المذاب تنازع فيه الفعلان وحذف من الأول لإعمال الثاني فأفرغ النحاس المذاب على الحديد المحمى فدخل بين زبره فصار شيئا واحدا فما استطاعوا أن يأجوج ومأجوج أن يظهروه يعلو ظهره لارتفاعه وملاسته وما استطاعوا له نقبا خرقا لصلابته وسمكه قال ذو القرنين هذا أي السد أي الإقدار عليه رحمة من ربي نعمة لأنه مانع من خروجهم فإذا جاء وعد ربي بخروجهم القريب من البعث جعله دكا مدكوكا مبسوطا وكان وعد ربي بخروجهم وغيره حقا كائنا. Right here in the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us how Dhul Qarnayn responded to their request. Basically, they said, if we give you some money, will you build us? If we give you this tribute, will you build us a barrier or a wall that will prevent Ya'juj and Ma'juj from attacking us? He says, قَالَ مَا مَكَّنِّي فِيهِ رَبِّي خَيْرٌ فَأَعِينُونِي بِقُوَّةٍ أَجْعَلْ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ رَدْمًا He said, what my Lord has provided for me is way better, but assist me with resources, and I will build a barrier between you and them. Right? Dhul Qarnayn said, the power my Lord has given me is better than any tribute, but if you lend me your strength, I will put up a barrier between you and them. قال يعني ذو القرنين said ما مكنني what my Lord has given me ما مكنني فيه the strength and authority and power and skills and wealth and resources that my Lord has provided for me خير is better than any tribute that you can give to me. Then he says the word مكنني وفي قراءة in another قراءة بنونين مكنني من غير إدغام without assimilating the two noons together. So the قراءة that we are used to is مكنني and there's another مكنني. Right? And they mean the same thing. فيه ربي من المال وغيره that what my Lord has provided for me in terms of wealth and other things, other resources. In terms of manpower, authority, justice, and rule, and intelligence, and everything needed to be a successful, just, upright ruler, خيرٌ is far better من خرجكم than the tribute الذي تجعلونه لي. Right, is much better than the tribute that you are going to give to me. فلا حاجة بي إليه. So I have no need for it. وأجعل لكم السد تبرعاً. And I will make this barrier for you, تبرعاً, for free, as an act of kindness, as an act of charity. But, فَأَعِينُونِي بِقُوَّةٍ Assist me with your strength. Assist me with your strength and resources. لِمَا أَطْلُبُهُ مِنْكُمْ And assist me with your resources and your strength that I am going to request from you. أَجْعَلْ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ رَدْمًا And I will build a barrier between you and them. And he says, رَدْمًا means حَاجِزًا حَصِينًا A fortified barrier. Right? A fortified barrier, a strong barrier. آتوني زُبَرَ الْحَدِيدِ Bring me blocks of iron. حَتَّى إِذَا سَاوَى بَيْنَ الصَّدَفَيْنِ Then, when he had filled up the gap between the two mountains, قَالَ انْفُخُوا He ordered blow. حتى إذا جعله نارا. And when the iron became red hot, قال آتوني أفرغ عليه قطرا. He said, bring me molten copper to pour over it. So bring me bricks, bring me blocks of iron. And then, when he had filled the gap between the two mountain sides, he said, work your bellows. And then, when he had made it glow like fire, he said, bring me molten metal or copper to pour over it. And this is how he constructed this fortified barrier. So, آتوني زبر الحديد. Bring me pieces, blocks, bricks of iron. قطعه. Right, bring me these pieces of iron. على قدر الحجارة. Right, that are equivalent to the size of stones. التي يبنى بها. That are used to build things. So like cinder, you know, like a cinder block or like bricks. So bring me pieces of iron that are equivalent in size, equal in size to these stones that are used to build things and construct things. فبنى بها. So he built a barrier with these pieces of iron. وجعل بينها الحطب. And in between these pieces of iron, or if there's any gaps in between, he put wood والفحم. Right, he put wood and faham. Hatta idha sawa bayna sudufain. He uses a different qira'ah. Until he filled the space between the two mountainsides. So extremely high, tall. He filled the entire space between the two mountainsides. Right? And he says the word sudufaini bi dhammi al-harfain, yani with a dhamma on the sad and the dal, wa fathihima, which is the qira'ah we are more used to. Sadafain. Right? Which means the two sides of the mountain. And another qira'ah, وَضَمِّ الْأَوَّلِ وَسُكُونِ الثَّانِي. A third way of reading it is صُدْفَيْن. So you have صُدُفَيْن, صُدْفَيْن, and صَدَفَيْن. All three. A, جَانِبَيِّ الْجَبَلَيْنِ بِالْبِنَاءِ. Right, until he filled the space in between the two sides of the mountain with this construction. Right, with this wall, with this barrier made of iron. And then he put this material in between. وَوَضَعَ الْمَنَافِخَ وَالنَّارِ حَوْلَ ذَلِكَ. And then around this barrier, they put fire, and manafikh are like these bellows. Right? I don't know if you guys have seen like these old school, you know, iron workers. They have these bellows that use it to blow it, and it becomes, the iron becomes even hotter. Right? They use that. So قَالَ انْفُخُوا. Right? Then ذُو الْقَرْنَيْنِ said to them, blow using your bellows onto this structure. Onto this barrier. فَنَفَخُوا. So they did so. حَتَّى إِذَا جَعَلَهُ نَارًا. Right, until they made that iron into something like fire. Became red hot. أَيَ الْحَدِيدَ نَارًا أَيَ كَالنَّارِ. Right, until they made that iron like fire. So it became red hot. Super hot. قال, when that happened, he said, آتوني أفرغ عليه قطرة. Bring me molten copper and I will pour it over it. So what is قطرًا? Here Imam al-Mahalli says, هو النحاس المذاب. Molten copper. Right, now he says over here in this verse, آتوني أفرغ عليه قطرًا تنازع فيه الفعلان. He's highlighting a very interesting grammatical construction where you have two verbs that are basically competing with each other, right, for the word qitran, for this maf'ul bihi, because it's the maf'ul bihi of atuni and it's also a maf'ul bihi of ufrigh. So both of these verbs are competing with each other in this word qitran. So tanaza'a fihi al-fa'lan. أي تنازع في قوله تعالى قطرا الفعلان آتوني أن أفرغ. So the actual construction reads آتوني قطرا أفرغ عليه قطرا. Right, that's how it actually is originally. فحذف الأول. So the first قطرا يعني آتوني قطرا has been omitted and dropped off. لدلالة الثاني عليه, because the second one indicates towards that first one anyways. So this is a, you know, a more complicated grammatical structure that is learned in Arabic. And just like there's differences of opinion, in fiqh, there are also differences of opinion in certain grammatical things. So over here, the scholars of Basra, they have a certain perspective on how this works, and the grammarians from Kufa have a different perspective on how this works. And this is something that you learn when you go deeper into Arabic grammar, علم النحو. نعم. So وحذف الأول. Here Imam al-Mahalli says وحذف من الأول لإعماد الثاني, that the first one has been omitted because the second verb is the one that's actually the amil, that's the one that's causing it to be mansub here, according to one of the madhabs of the Nuhat, any one of the opinions of the grammarians. فأفرغ النحاس المذاب على الحديد المحمى. So ذو القرنين poured that molten copper over that red hot iron. فدخل بين زبره. So that molten copper, right, entered into the spaces between those pieces of iron, making it one solid structure. فصار شيئا واحدا. So became one solid, impenetrable structure. فَمَسْطَاعُ, and that's what he highlights here then. فَمَسْطَاعُ أَن يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَسْتَطَاعُ لَهُ نَقْبًا. And so they could neither scale it nor tunnel through it. Right? They could not scale the barrier. They couldn't climb over it, nor could they pierce through it because of its height and thickness. So, فَمَسْطَاعُ أَي يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ. يَأْجُوجُ and مَأْجُوجُ were not able to scale the barrier. يَعْلُو ظَهْرَهُ, right, climb over it. لِرْتِفَاعِهِ, because of how high it was. وَمَلَاسَتِهِ, and because of how smooth it was. You couldn't climb it. وَمَسْتَطَاعُ لَهُ نَقْبًا, nor could they pierce a hole in it. خَرْقًا, they were not able to pierce a hole in it. لِصَلَابَتِهِ, because of its thickness. وَسُمْكِهِ, and its denseness, of how, you know, how thick and solid it was. Right, and it is said that, you know, every day, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, according to a riwayah, they're constantly digging through, and they do it all day until they're almost about to break through. And they say, oh, you know what, we'll break through tomorrow, let's stop for today. And then the next morning when they come back, all the work they did goes to waste. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala builds that barrier back and refills that space. And they keep doing that until their appointed time comes, which is near the end of times. You know, when after Isa alayhi salam basically kills the Dajjal, right, near the end of times, then Allah will decree that one of them was going to say, Insha'Allah, Insha'Allah tomorrow will break through. And once they do that, they'll break through, and then they're going to, you know, spread craziness across the globe. They're going to, you know, use up all the resources, kill everyone in sight, and it's going to be a very difficult trial. It's one of the trials that is going to happen near the end of times. So وَمَسْتَطَاعُ لَهُ نَقْبًا, they are unable to pierce through it. لِصَلَابَتِهِ وَسُمْكِهِ. قَالَ هَذَا رَحْمَةٌ مِّن رَبِّي. So ذُو الْقَرْنَيْنِ then says, this is a mercy from my Lord. فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي جَعَلَهُ دَكَّا. But when the promise of my Lord comes, he will level it to the ground. وَكَانَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي حَقًّا. And the promise of my Lord is true. So قال يعني ذو القرنين. ذو القرنين said هذا أي أسد. This barrier that I was able to help construct and build, أي الإقدار عليه. Having the ability to build and construct such a barrier that's going to keep back يأجوج and مأجوج, رحمة من ربي. Has nothing to do with me. Has nothing to do with my intelligence, my capabilities, my abilities, my power, my strength, my resources. No. رَحْمَةٌ مِّن رَبِّي, this is a mercy from my Lord. نِعْمَةٌ, a blessing from my Lord. لِأَنَّهُ مَانِعٌ مِّن خُرُوجِهِمْ, because it's a barrier that's preventing يَأْجُوجَ and مَأْجُوجَ from coming. But فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي, but when the promise of my Lord does come, بِخُرُوجِهِمْ, with their escape, الْقَرِيبِ مِّنَ الْبَعْثِ, that is going to take place close to the day of resurrection, جَعَلَهُ دَكَّا, Allah will level it. مَدْكُوكًا, right, he will destroy it. مَبْسُوطًا, level with the ground. وَكَانَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي حَقًّا, and the promise of my Lord is true. بِخُرُوجِهِمْ وَغَيْرِهِ, the promise of my Lord of them exiting and escaping from this barrier and wreaking havoc across the globe, and other things like the coming of the Dajjal and the coming of return of Isa alayhi salam. All of that is true. The Day of Judgment is true. Ka'inan, meaning is going to happen without a doubt.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال هذا رحمة من ربي فإذا جاء وعد ربي جعله دكا وكان وعد ربي حقا وتركنا بعضهم يومئذ يموج في بعض ونفخ في الصور فجمعناهم جمعا وعرضنا جهنم يومئذ للكافرين عرضا الذين كانت أعينهم في غطاء عن ذكري وكانوا لا يستطيعون سمعا أفحسب الذين كفروا أن يتخذوا عبادي من دوني أولياء إنا أعتدنا جهنم للكافرين نزلا قل هل ننبئكم بالأخسرين أعمالا الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا وهم يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا أولئك الذين كفروا بآيات ربهم ولقائه فحبطت أعمالهم فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا ذلك جزاؤهم جهنم بما كفروا واتخذوا آياتي ورسلي هزوا إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا قال رحمه الله قال تعالى وتركنا بعضهم يومئذ يوم خروجهم يموج في بعض يختلط به لكثرتهم ونفخ في الصور أي القرن للبعث فجمعناهم أي الخلائق في مكان واحد يوم القيامة جمعا وعرضنا قربنا جهنم يومئذ للكافرين عرضا الذين كانت أعينهم بدل من الكافرين في غطاء عن ذكري أي القرآن فهم عمي لا يهتدون به وكانوا لا يستطيعون سمعا أي لا يقدرون أن يسمعوا من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما يتلو عليهم بغضا له فلا يؤمنون به أفحسب الذين كفروا أن يتخذوا عبادي أي ملائكة وعيسى وعزيرا من دوني أولياء أربابا مفعول ثان ليتخذوا والمفعول الثاني لحسب محذوف المعنى أظنوا أن الاتخاذ المذكور لا يغضبني ولا أعاقبهم عليه كلا إنا أعتدنا جهنم للكافرين هؤلاء وغيرهم نزلا أي هي معدة لهم كالمنزل المعد للضيف
Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now describing how Ya'juj and Ma'juj are going to wreak havoc across the earth. وَتَرَكْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَمُوجُ فِي بَعْضٍ On that day, we will let them surge like waves one over the other. On that day, we will let them surge like waves over one another. وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ Later, the trumpet will be blown.
فَجَمَعْنَاهُمْ جَمَعًا And we will gather all people together. Another translation reads, On that day, we shall let them surge against each other like waves. And then the trumpet will be blown. And we shall gather them all together. So قَالَ تَعَالَى Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتَرَكْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَوْمَ خُرُوجِهِمْ That on that day, meaning the day they escape, the day they break through that barrier, right? The day they exit and break through that fortified barrier, تَرَكْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ يَمُوجُ فِي بَعْضٍ We will let them surge like waves over one another. وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ حَدَبٍ يَنْسِلُونَ Right, because of their large number, because of their large population, it's going to be like waves of people coming down from those mountain passes and just spreading across the globe, using up all the resources, drinking up all the water, eating all the food, and killing everyone in their sight. As is mentioned in a riwayah. And once they've killed everyone in their sight on this earth, they're going to be like, you know, we've killed everyone on the earth, let's kill everyone in the skies. And they're going to shoot these arrows towards the heaven. And Allah will send back those arrows with blood on them. And they're going to be fooled that thinking they've killed people in the sky as well. And during that time, Isa alayhi salam is going to be told to take the believers and seek refuge and fortify himself on Mount Tur. And other believers will seek refuge in their own areas and they will be protected and saved. And then Isa alayhi salam and those will make dua. And Allah is going to send some sort of pandemic, some sort of disease, a worm that's going to come and destroy all of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. And it will kill all of them, every single one of them. And then the entire world and earth will be filled with their corpses and putrid bodies. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send this rain and water that will wash away their bodies. And then there's going to be a period of relative peace, about 40 years, where you know Isa alayhi salam and the believers are living in prosperity and all the good things are happening. Then after that, a wind is going to come and take all the believers away, and only the worst people of the earth are going to be left, and the day of judgment will begin, meaning the end of times will come upon them. Wallahu a'lam. You know, all of these are min alamat al-sa'a and studied in eschatology and mentioned in the books of Aqidah. And you know, for more information, I would suggest reading some material that talks about the events of the last day and the signs of the day of judgment. The title of the book that I would recommend just slipped my mind, so I'll share it with everyone in the next lesson, inshallah. Right, so Allah will let them come down, right, like waves over one another. يَخْتَيْتُ بِهِ لِكَثْرَتِهِمْ Right, they'll be mixing with each other because of their large number. وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ And the trumpet will be blown. This is referring to the trumpet. What it looks like? Allahu A'lam. Only the name is the same. We don't know what this trumpet looks like. But what we do know is that the angel Israfil has been commanded to blow into this trumpet. And the first time he does so, every single thing is going to cease to exist. And then the second time, everything will be brought back to life. And that's what's being referred to here. وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ That the trumpet will be blown by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-qarn. Right, another word for asur is al-qarn. This is an instrument that is created by Allah. Its reality is only known by Allah. And this second sounding is lil-ba'th, is to resurrect and bring all of mankind back to life. And everyone's going to rise from their graves. فَجَمَعْنَاهُمْ أَيَّ الْخَلَائِقَ فِي مَكَانٍ وَاحِدٍ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ And we will gather them, meaning who? Al-khala'iq, all of creation, in one place, which is the place of gathering. On the Day of Judgment, Jama'a, we shall gather them all together. وَعَرَضْنَا جَهَنَّمَ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلْكَافِرِينَ عَرْضًا On that day, we will display hell clearly for the disbelievers. Right, clearly, for the non-believers, hell will be on display, creating an extra sense of fear and regret and remorse and terror and sorrow and sadness. وَعَرَضْنَا يَعْنِي قَرَّبْنَا جَهَنَّمَ We will display hellfire, we will bring hellfire close. يَوْمَ إِذٍ On that day, لِلْكَافِرِينَ Right, for the non-believers. أَلَّذِينَ كَانَتْ أَعْيُنُهُمْ فِي غِطَاءٍ عَنْ ذِكْرِ وَكَانُوا لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ سَمْعًا Which non-believers? Those who turned a blind eye to my reminder and could not stand listening to it. Those whose eyes were blind to my signs. Those who rejected the ayat of Allah. And those who were unable to hear. Meaning they refused to think, ponder, and reflect. So, الَّذِينَ كَانَتْ أَعْيُنُهُمْ. Those non-believers whose eyes في غِطَاءٍ عَنْ ذِكْرِ. Those whose eyes were blind to my reminder. So, كَانَتْ أَعْيُنُهُمْ. He says this is بَدَلٌ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. This الَّذِينَ كَانَتْ أَعْيُنُهُمْ is بَدَلٌ. It is the replacement for الْكَافِرِينَ. Right? Hellfire will be brought close to these people. So, كَانَتْ أَعْيُنُهُمْ فِي غِطَاءٍ. Their eyes were blind عَنْ ذِكْرِ. From my reminder, meaning the Qur'an. فَهُمْ عُمْيٌ. So, they are like spiritually blind. لَا يَهْتَدُونَ بِهِ. Who do not achieve guidance with the Qur'an. The Prophet ﷺ recited the Qur'an to them. They heard it, but they did not accept it. Or any other non-believers who reject the Qur'an. وَكَانُوا لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ سَمْعًا. They were unable to hear the Qur'an. A hearing that would benefit them. أَيْ لَا يَقْدِرُونَ أَنْ يَسْمَعُوا مِنَ النَّبِيَ ﷺ مَا يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ. That they were unable to hear, right, what the Prophet ﷺ recited to them. بُغْضًا لَهُ. Out of their hatred and enmity for it. فَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ. So they didn't believe. Right. Those are the non-believers being described here. Then Allah poses this question. أَفَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَن يَتَّخِذُوا عِبَادِي مِن دُونِ أَوْلِيَاءِ إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا جَهَنَّمَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ نُزُلًا. Do the non-believers think they can simply take my servants as lords instead of me? We have surely prepared hell as an accommodation for the non-believers. Did they think, did they believe that they could take my servants as deities, as lords, instead of me? We have prepared hell as their resting place. Did they really think they could commit shirk and get away with it? So, أَفَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Right? Did those who disbelieve really think and really believe أَن يَتَّخِذُوا عِبَادِي that they could take my servants, meaning my angels, Isa alayhi salam, Uzair salam, min duni awliya, as guardians and protectors besides me, arbaban, as lords. And he says the word is maf'ulun thanin liyattakhidu. Right? It's the maf'ulun thanin liyattakhidu. And the maf'ul thani for hasiba is omitted. And the meaning is, adhannu anna al-ittikhad al-madhkur la yughdibuni. Did they believe and think that them taking these servants of mine as their lords and deities, right, would not upset me and not make me angry? وَلَا أُعَاقِبُهُمْ عَلَيْهِ. And that I will not punish them for that? كَلَّا. No way. Never. إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا جَهَنَّمَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. Truly we have prepared Jahannam for the non-believers. هَؤُلَا. Those that associated partners with me and took guardians besides me. وَغَيْرِهِمْ. And others, all the non-believers. نُزُولًا. We have prepared hellfire as an accommodation, as a resting place for them. Then he highlights what is نُزُل. هِيَ مُعَدَّةٌ لَهُمْ. That hellfire has been prepared for them. Just like a house is prepared for a guest. That's the word of نُزُل. نُزُل is like the space that you prepare for a guest you're inviting. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that He has prepared hellfire for these non-believers. قال رحمه الله قل هل ننبئكم بالأخسرين أعمالا تمييز طابق المميز وبينهم بقوله الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا بطل عملهم وهم يحسبون يظنون أنهم يحسنون صنعا عملا يجازون عليه أولئك الذين كفروا بآيات ربهم بدلائل توحيده من القرآن وغيره ولقائه أي وبالبعث والحساب والثواب والعقاب فحبطت أعمالهم بطلت فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا أي لا نجعل لهم قدرا ذلك أي الأمر ذلك الذي ذكرت من حبوط أعمالهم وغيرهم وابتدأ جزاؤهم جهنم بما كفروا واتخذوا آياتي ورسلي هزوا أي مهزوءا بهما إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم في علم الله جنات الفردوس هو وسط الجنة وأعلاها والإضافة إليه للبيان نزولا منزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون يطلبون عنها حولا تحولا إلى غيرها الله سبحانه وتعالى now poses another rhetorical question قل هل ننبئكم بالأخسرين أعمالا say shall we inform you of who will lose the most deeds say shall we tell you who has the most to lose by their actions بالأخسرين أعمالا right say O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم هل ننبئكم shall we inform you about those who are the worst losers أخسرين they have lost the most in terms of what in terms of their deeds meaning all of their good deeds have gone to waste their good deeds will not benefit them whatsoever in the hereafter right, so قل here Imam al-Mahalli says say O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم هل ننبئكم shall we inform you بالأخسرين about those who are the worst of losers أعمالا in terms of deeds and here himself he says that the word أعمالا it's تمييز right it's منصوب because it's playing the grammatical rule of تمييز it is disambiguation طابق المميز and it agrees with the thing that's being explained and clarified وبينهم بقوله And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself explains who they are with his statement. الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا Whose efforts in this world are misguided. Even when they think they are doing good work. They are those whose efforts are in vain in this worldly life. ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ Their efforts in this worldly life, in vain, no benefit, useless. وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ While they think and believe, أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا While they think and believe that they're doing good. So who are the worst losers in terms of their deeds on the Day of Judgment? الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا Those whose efforts have gone in vain. Those whose efforts have been wasted in the life of this world, بَطَلَ أَعْمَلُهُمْ Their deeds are باطل, are in vain, void, useless. وَهُمْ يَحْسِبُونَ He uses a different qira'ah. We have يَحْسَبُونَ, he has يَحْسِبُونَ, same meaning. And while they believe, يَظُنُّونَ, while they believe, أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا That they are doing good work. عَمَلًا That they are doing deeds, يُجَازَوْنَ عَلَيْهِ That they're going to receive reward for. But they will not. They will not get any reward because the condition for receiving reward and deeds being accepted is missing, which is Iman. They don't have Iman. So their deeds go to waste. They might get some reward in this dunya and they'll be given the reward full in this dunya. But they will not get anything in the akhirah. And that is why they are أَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا That is why they are the greatest losers in terms of their deeds, because all of their deeds go to waste. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ وَلِقَائِهِ Allah continues to explain who they are. It is they who reject the signs of their Lord and their meeting with Him. فَحَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ So their deeds become void. فَلَا نُقِيمُ لَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَزْنًا So we will not give their deeds any weight on the Day of Judgment. So أولئك, right, those people that have just been described, whose efforts are in vain in the life of this world, although they think they're doing good, they are who? الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ They are the ones who reject and disbelieve in the signs of their Lord, the signs of His oneness, in terms of the Qur'an and other things, meaning the non-believers. وَلِقَائِهِ And they reject their meeting with him. They deny that they're going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning they don't believe in life after death. They don't believe in accountability and judgment. A, وَبِالْ بَعْثِ. They deny resurrection, hisab, they deny the accounting, والثواب, reward and punishment. Because they don't believe in the concept of life after death. فَحَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ. So their deeds go to waste. بَطَلَتْ. Their deeds are in vain, void, go to waste, useless. فَلَا نُقِيمُ لَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَزْنَا. So we will not give their deeds any weight on the day of judgment. A. لَا نَجْعَلُ لَهُمْ قَدَرًا. We will not give them any qadr on the day of judgment, any weight, any value. ذَلِكَ جَزَاؤُهُمْ جَهَنَّمُ بِمَا كَفَرُوا وَاتَّخَذُوا آيَاتِي وَرُسُلِي هُزُوًا. That is their repayment. That is their recompense for having disbelieved and made fun of my messages and my messengers. That is their recompense. Hell for their disbelief and mockery of my signs and messengers. So they are being punished because of their disbelief and their arrogance and their pride and their mockery and their ridicule. And this is from the infinite ultimate justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ذلك A. الأمر ذلك الذي ذكرت من حبوط أعمالهم وغيره. ذلك meaning الأمر, the matter, the affair, is that which I have mentioned in terms of their actions going in vain and being useless. And others, وَابْتَدَأَ جَزَاؤُهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ. Yani he starts a new sentence, جَزَاؤُهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ. Their jaza, their recompense, their reward, جَهَنَّمْ, hellfire. Why? بِمَا كَفَرُوا, for having disbelieved. وَاتَّخَذُوا آيَاتِ, and for having taken my signs, my revelations, وَرُسُلِي, and my messengers, هُزُؤًا, as a mockery, as something to mock and make fun of. يعني مَهْزُؤًا بِهِمَا, for mocking and making fun of and ridiculing my signs and my messengers. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the believers. That's the reward, that is the punishment for the non-believers. At-tarhib, followed by at-tarhib. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ نُزُلًا خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا لَا يَبْغُونَ عَنْهَا حِوَلًا. Truly those who believe and do good will have the gardens of paradise as an accommodation, where they will be forever, never desiring anywhere else, never wishing to leave. So إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Truly those who believe in Allah and the Messenger and the Last Day, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and do righteous deeds, their iman translates into action, something tangible. كَانَتْ لَهُمْ فِي عِلْمِ اللَّهِ. For them, according to the infinite, eternal knowledge of Allah, جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ, gardens of الْفِرْدَوْسِ, and that is وَسَطُ الْجَنَّةِ وَأَعْلَاهَا, that is the middle of paradise in its highest level. والإضافة إليه, and the reason why the word جنات is مضاف to the word فردوس للبيان, right, to explain what type of جنات, جنات الفردوس, which is the highest, you know, status or the highest place in paradise. And the Prophet said, whenever you ask for جنات, ask for فردوس. نزولا منزلا, right, as an accommodation, as a place of welcome. خالدين فيها, they will reside there for eternity. لا يبغون يطلبون عنها حولا, not desiring to move from there ever, never wishing to leave, never desiring to go anywhere else. تحولاً إلى غيرها, right, never wishing to be moved or, you know, going anywhere other than فردوس. قال رحمه الله قل لو كان البحر أي ماؤه مدادا هو ما يكتب به لكلمات ربي الدالة على حكمه وعجائبه بأن تكتب به لنفد البحر في كتابتها قبل أن تنفد بالتاء والياء تفرغ كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله أي البحر مددا زيادة فيه لنفد إذا ولم تفرغ هي ونصبه على التمييز قل إنما أنا بشر آدمي مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد أن المكفوفة بما باقية على مصدريتها والمعنى يوحى إلي وحدانية الإله فمن كان يرجو يأمل لقاء ربه بالبعث والجزاء فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أي فيها بأن يرائي أحدا.
Now we are coming to the conclusion of Surah Al-Kahf. In verse 109, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an example, an illustration to help us understand the infinite, limitless nature of His knowledge. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge is never-ending, infinite and limitless.
قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ مِدَادًا لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي
Say, if the ocean were ink for recording the words of my Lord,
لَنَفِذَ الْبَحْرُ قَبْلَ أَن تَنْفَذَ كَلِمَاتُ رَبِّي
It would certainly run out before the words of my Lord were finished.
وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا
Even if we refilled it with its equal. Say, if the whole ocean were ink for writing the words of my Lord, it would run dry before those words were exhausted, even if we were to add another ocean to it.
So قُلْ And he say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
give your community, the companions and the non-believers, this very detailed illustration.
لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ أَيْ مَاؤُهُ
If the water of the oceans were مِدَادًا, were ink. If the oceans were ink,
وَهُوَ مَا يُكْتَبُ بِ
يعني مِدَادًا is what is used to write, meaning ink. If the oceans were ink,
لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي
يعني for writing the words of my Lord.
الدَّالَّتِ
that indicate towards حِكَمِهِ that indicate towards His divine wisdom.
وَعَجَائِبِهِ
and His wonders.
بِأَن تُكْتَبَ بِ
that those words be written with that ink.
لَنَفِدَ الْبَحْرُ
The ocean would run out. That ink would run out.
فِي كِتَابَتِهَا
Right, that ink would be exhausted and run out in writing the words of Allah, meaning the knowledge of Allah and His wisdom.
قَبْلَ أَن تَنْفَذَ كَلِمَاتُ رَبِّي
Before the words of my Lord would be exhausted. And he says,
تَنْفَذَ بِالتَّاءِ وَالْيَا تَفْرُغَ
Right, before the words of my Lord would be exhausted.
وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا
Even if we were to add another ocean to it. Even if we brought, you know, another ocean of ink, that would also run out. And this is something similar mentioned in Surah Luqman as well. And again, is it Surah Luqman? Afwan. I think Surah Luqman. Right, where this similar type of illustration is mentioned to highlight the infinite and limitless nature of Allah's knowledge and wisdom. And you know, there's some numbers there that are totally mind-boggling, meaning the amount of water in the oceans, right? Trillions, and I don't even know how many gallons of water. If all of that water were turned into ink, and all of the trees in this universe were turned into pens, and they were to write down the wisdom and knowledge and wonders of Allah, the pens would break, the ink would run out, but the knowledge of Allah would still continue. Even if those oceans were refilled as ink, and it started again, still, because Allah's knowledge is infinite.
نعم مَدَدًا زِيَادَةً فِيهِ لَنَفِدَ إِذًا
Right, if you added more, that would also run out.
وَلَمْ تَفْرُخِيَ
And Allah's words would not be exhausted.
وَنَصْبُهُ
يعني مَدَدًا It's منصوب على التمييز Right, it is playing that role of تمييز.
قُلْ Allah ends the surah by saying قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ
Say, I am only a man like you. I am only a human being just like you.
يُوحَى إِلَيْ
But it has been revealed to me
أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ
That your God is only one God.
فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ
So whoever hopes
for the meeting with their Lord, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. Let them do good deeds, وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّي أَحَدًا, and associate none in the worship of their Lord. Say, I am only a human being like you, to whom it has been revealed that your God is one. Anyone who fears to meet his Lord should do good deeds and give no one a share in the worship due to his Lord. So قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ آدَمِيٌ. Say, I am only a human being, مِثْلُكُمْ, like you. There isn't any unique, out of the ordinary features of me as a human being. I speak like you, I eat like you, I walk like you, I talk like you. Yes, I am a human being. But Allah has appointed me as a prophet and messenger. Allah has given me revelation. يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ. He has revealed to me, أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ, that your إِلَهُ, إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ, is one. And he says that the أَنَّ here, right, يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ, is مَكْفُوفَ بِمَا بَاقِيَةٌ عَلَى مَصْدَرِيَّتِهَا. That it's still playing the role of مَا مَصْدَرِيَّة, or أَن مَصْدَرِيَّة. وَالْمَعْنَى يُوحَى إِلَيَّ, that it is revealed to me, وَحْدَانِيَّةُ الْإِلَهِ, the oneness of Allah has been revealed to me. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرُجُوا يَأْمُلُ لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ. So whoever hopes and expects to meet their Lord, بِالْبَعْثِ وَالْجَزَاءِ, through resurrection and recompense, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا, then they should do righteous deeds. If you truly believe in the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment, then do righteous deeds. وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّي أَحَدًا, and do not associate anyone in the worship of their Lord. And they should not associate anyone in the worship of their Lord. And here Imam al-Mahli says this means رِيَاءً. أَيْفِيهَا. Don't associate anyone in the worship of Allah بِأَنْ يُرَائِيَ, by showing off through ostentation, which is known as الشِّرْكُ الْأَصْغَرُ, minor shirk. Are doing things to show off and through ostentation. And it can also be referring to major shirk as well. Right, and that brings us to the end of this very powerful, profound, important, and noble surah. And as I mentioned, we are simply going through Al-Jalalain, Tafsir Al-Jalalain. So it's very concise and brief and succinct. But, for a more detailed and thorough exploration of the surah, I again encourage all of you to visit our YouTube channel and, check out the series that we have on the tafsir of Surah Al-Kahf. And inshallah, very near in the future, we'll be publishing a book on the tafsir of Surah Al-Kahf. And I encourage you to read other more detailed tafsir, look in Ma'arif Al-Quran and tafsir of Ibn Kathir, and read through the explanation of Surah Al-Kahf. And interestingly, when this recording is going to play, it's going to be after Maghrib, and it's going to be Thursday evening, which is actually Friday, and that is one of the times where we are recommended to recite these last 10 verses, or the first 10 verses. So that happens to be an interesting coincidence, but may Allah accept, and may Allah make us among those who not only understand the surah, but make a habit of reading it and memorizing it, and most importantly, understanding it. Because the virtue of this surah that's mentioned, that is going to help us and protect us from the fitna of Dajjal, right, that virtue will be actualized if we understand the message of the surah and we implement it in our lives and we follow its guidance. By doing so, we will be protected from the trial and the fitna of Dajjal. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who not only recite the Qur'an and memorize the Qur'an, but try our best to understand it and implement its teachings and guidance into our daily lives. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا وَمَوْلَانَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلِّمْ. جَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.